தூரம் அறிவு வாட்டர் will flow from your well in the sand in proportion in proportion to the depth to which it is dug and knowledge will flow from a man in proportion to his learning here legal knowledge will flow from beyond law clc and it has been flowing in proportion to one's watching hearing learning grasping storing and using capacity of the webinar lectures thanks to beyond law clc and mr vikash I think beyond law clc and Littles of Kerala are the two marathon lecture series in India maybe in world too even a marathon would be finished in a certain distance but I pray that lecture series to be continued forever for our legal empowerment mr vikash has been conducting these webinar lecture series tirelessly his dedication insight enthusiasm are really inspiring I wish him many years of great achievements congratulations sir I am not a lecturer or professor with my little experience I am going to share my views on this subject we are all know that right of an accused to watch the prosecution witnesses deposing before a court of law indisputably is a valuable right we may however notice that such a right has not been accepted as a fundamental right within the meaning of article 21 of the constitution of india an accused is however always entitled to a fair trial the right to cross examine a witness apart from being a natural right is a statutory right an accused has not only a valuable right to represent himself he has also the right to be informed thereabout under section 273 of crpc evidence is to be recorded in the presence of the accused you are aware that while recording the evidence the presence of the accused is not necessary and his or her counsel may represent the case and cross examine the witness the accused may present or may not present but his or her counsel must present and participate in the trial proceedings if evidence is recorded without the presence of both the accused and the counsel the defense counsel may rely upon section 273 of crpc and would submit that the procedure adopted by the trial court of recording statements of the witnesses without ensuring the presence of the accused amount to an incurable illegality and as such the trial ought to be declared to be vitiated and the accused be acquitted of all charges leveled against them one of the first instances in which evidence was allowed to be recorded by the honorable supreme court through video conference in 2002 in a criminal case of state of maharashtra versus dr praful b desai 2003 4 sec 601 the right of an accused to watch the proceeding watch the prosecution witnesses deposing before the court is a valuable right and infringement of such right is gravely prejudicial the contravention of section 273 was remedied by the order of retrial so that there should not be any prejudice to the accused if you want you can also see Atmaram and others versus state of Rajasthan Sakshi and others versus Union of India Mahendra Chawla versus Union of India in respect of section 273 and the right of the accused in this regard is there any exception to 273 the only exception to the application of section 273 are those expressly provided that is section 205 317 and 299 of crpc and together with section 82 subject to these exceptions section 273 is absolutely mandatory the first two provisions are very familiar to the courts and advocates however while furnishing copies under section 207 of crpc first questioning or framing of charges identification of the accused during trial final questioning under section 313(1)(b) of crpc and judgment the accused must be present in petty cases and some pleaded guilty summon cases even the presence of the accused is not necessary and his counsel could appear and defend at all stages today we are going to discuss the procedure for examination of witnesses in the absence of the accused it is very interesting procedure but unfortunately it has not been followed by several courts in our country when the accused is absconded the court would always issue non-bailable warrant for execution but fails to take further action the issue of absconding the issue of upstanding accused is one of the major cause for the pendency of criminal cases before trial courts. Therefore, it is important that the trial courts and advocates themselves well to deal effectively with this issue. The Honorable High Courts are repeatedly issuing ROCs, thereby directing the judicial magistrate and courts to follow the procedure under Section 299 of CRPC. But due to pressure of work or some other reason, the courts find no time to take further steps apart from issuance of NPW. Thus, the accused are very happy, left the jurisdiction of the courts, flee away to abroad, and concealing themselves for long time, even several years. How to stop the substandards and how to bring the accused to the courts? It is very easy and simple if we follow the procedure under Section 299 of CRPC, that is recording of evidence in the absence of the accused and also in the absence of the defense counsel. Will it not give trouble to the accused at a later stage? The court on the case before the court by executing non-bailable warrant, definitely it will affect the accused. Section 299 of CRPC, the first part speaks of the circumstances under which witnesses produced by the prosecution could be examined in the accused. And the second part speaks of the circumstances when such a deposition can be given in evidence against the accused in any inquiry or trial for the offense with which he is charged. It is with recording of evidence at two stages, namely where the accused is absent and there is no immediate prospect of his arrest. Number two, where the offender is unknown, the case in which the offender is unknown when before the court. In first case, the court can record depositions of prosecution witnesses. These can be offered at the trial in three stages. If witnesses is dead, if he is incapable of giving evidence, or if his attendance would cause unreasonable delay, expense or inconvenience. Secondly, where the offender is unknown and the offense committed is punishable with death or imprisonment for life, the Honorable High Court or the session judge may direct the judicial magistrate to hold an inquiry and examine the witnesses and record the deposition. Depositions so recorded in that proceedings may be used at trial at three stages. Number one, if the witness is dead, is incapable of giving evidence, is beyond the limits of India. So for application of Section 299 of CRPC, there should be a definite finding to the effect that witnesses died at the time of trial or become incapable of giving evidence. Section 299.1 deals with an absconder of accused, but Section 299.2 deals with an unknown offender. Now the question is, who has to record the evidence of the witnesses in the absence of accused? Number one, the court competent to try. Thus, all the judicial magistrate, all the courts are empowered to examine the witnesses. Number two, the court competent to commit the trial. Thus, in respect of criminal recent cases also, the magistrate can record evidence. Thus, the judicial magistrate can examine the witnesses in preliminary register case also, even though it is the offences are tried by a session judge. In respect of other cases where the accused substandard, irrespective of the stage, all the judicial magistrate or courts are empowered to examine the witnesses under Section 299 of CRPC. Then how to use the depositions? Such depositions recorded may, on the arrest of the accused person, be used in evidence against him if the deponent is dead or is incapable of giving evidence or his attendance cannot be conveniently procured. When the case to be shifted from relevant register to regular register to register of long pending case in Tamil Nadu, as soon as the proceedings under Section 82 is initiated, the court shall shift the case from relevant register to register of long pending cases in administrative form number 30 register that we used to call. In few states like Andhra Pradesh, Karnataka, Kerala, etc., the judicial magistrate shall report the case for the order of the session judge, who may, if he thinks fit, order that the case shall be removed from the register of a case received, register of the case received, and then be entered in the register of long pending cases, Before directing transfer of case to register of long pending cases, the session judge shall satisfy himself that all reasonable steps have been taken to follow the procedure prescribed under section 82 and 83 of CRPC, and also when practicable that the provisions of section 299 of CRPC have been complied with. In Tamil Nadu also, before criminal rules of practice 2019, all the magistrate should have obtained permission from the chief judicial magistrate. Without obtaining permission from the chief judicial magistrate, a magistrate cannot record evidence under section 299. Now as per our new rules of practice 2019, such permission is not necessary. If subsequently the accused appeared, or any of them are produced or appear before the court, or those who have been obstructing or persistently disturbing the proceedings undertake to cooperate with the court, the case against them shall be registered under the new number. The date of issuance of proclamation, date fixed for the appearance of the accused, date of attachment if any, description of the attached property if any, method and the date of disposal of attached property, date of examination of the witnesses, and the date of appearance of the accused or date of death shall be recorded in the long pending case register. The said long pending case register shall be kept register and long pending case shall be kept pending separately without giving any date of hearing till the accused is produced or appears or dead, and thereafter issue a NPW to the police again and monitor the warrant. The said long pending case shall be kept pending for 30 years and thereafter it can be included in the destruction list. Now the another question is whether the court can pass either order of sentence or discharge of the accused after recording evidence. Using the evidence recorded in the absence of accused, whether the court can punish the sentence or discharge or acquit the accused? No. In state by R.T. Nagar versus Manikantha, latest judgment 2020 January 24, the Honorable High Court of Karnataka held that once a trial court has issued warrant under section 70 of CRPC for the offences punishable under 399 402 IPC in that case, and the proclamation and attachment under section 82 and 83, the option available to the trial court is only to record the evidence under section 299 of CRPC and keep the case pending under the long pending case register, and until securing the presence of the accused, the court cannot pass either the order of any sentence or discharge the accused or acquittal. Then what are the legal consequences? Number one, publication of proclamation is to require or compel the appearance of the accused. Number two, he shall surrender or arrested and be produced before the court. If the accused has sufficient cause for his non-appearance on the specified time and date, he may approach the court for recalling the warrant, and if he has been pronounced as proclaimed offender, he shall surrender himself before the court and plead to set aside the order passed by the trial court in the proceedings under section 82 of CRPC or 299 of CRPC. On such application, the court may pass suitable orders. See Anandan Douglas Devananda versus State of Inspector of Police 2011, One Madras Weekly Notes, Criminal 214, in this regard. What are the remedies available to the accused? Evidence has been recorded in his absence. What are the remedies available to the accused now he has appeared or produced subsequently? The accused would get only two chances. Number one, the accused can cross-examine the available witnesses or approach the higher forum for quashing the proceedings under section 299 of CRPC or 82 of CRPC and get direction to record fresh evidence alleging that the procedure for proclamation has not been followed strictly and the witnesses are very much available even now. Thus, it is necessary to follow the strict procedure under section 82 and 83 of CRPC. Otherwise, the entire exercise will be entered in futile. 299 CRPC is an exception to the principle embodied in section 833 of Indian Evidence Act. Section 33 of Indian Evidence Act applies to the cases in which evidence given by a witness, number one, in a judicial proceedings, number two, before any person who is authorized by law to take evidence. Such evidence is relevant in subsequent proceedings also, and at the later stage of the same proceedings. Thus, there are two stages in respect of subsequent proceedings or at the later stage of the same proceedings. Now we are going to follow the section 83 under ground number 2. At later stage of the same proceedings, evidence was recorded under section 299 CRPC at the initial stage, and it has to be used or applied in the subsequent later stage when accused appeared or produced through non-bailable warrant or surrender. The admissibility of such statement and the subject matter do not depend on their intrinsic character but on circumstances on which they are made. There are some reasons. Number one, when the witness is dead, he cannot be found. He is incapable of giving evidence. He is kept out of the way by the adverse party. His presence cannot be obtained without an amount of delay or expense which the court considers unreasonable. There are 5 reasons stated in section 33. Out of 5, except 4th, all the other 1, 2, 3 and 5 are mentioned in section 299. Namely, witness is dead, cannot be found, incapable of giving evidence, or cannot be obtained without an amount of delay or expenses which the court consider unreasonable. The evidence deposited by any one of these witnesses mentioned above will be admissible subject to fulfillment of 3 conditions under section 33. There are 3 provisos. Number one, the previous proceedings was between the same parties as in the subsequent one, or their representative in interest. The adverse party in previous proceedings had right and opportunity to cross-examine. In our case, under section 299, the question of adverse party in the previous proceeding does not arise. Number three, third proviso, the question and issue were substantially the same in the previous and subsequent proceedings also. Proviso number three also is not applicable, is not relevant to section 299 of CRPC. Now we can compare section 299 CRPC with 33 of Indian Evidence Act. Under section 33 of Indian Evidence Act, the evidence of a witness which a party has no right or opportunity to cross-examine is not legally admissible. Being an exception, it is necessary, therefore, that all the conditions prescribed must be strictly complied with under section 33. In other words, before recording the statement of witnesses produced by the prosecution, the court must be satisfied that the accused has absconded or that there is no immediate prospect of arresting him as provided under first part of section 299 of CRPC. Preconditions in both the sections must be established by the prosecution, and it is only then the statement of witnesses recorded under section 299 of CRPC before the arrest of the accused can be utilized in evidence in trial. After the arrest of such accused, only if the persons are dead or would not be available or any other condition enumerated in the second part of section 299 of CRPC is established. Even the deposition of the witnesses can be a basis for conviction under this provision. It is relevant to point out that Nirmal Singh versus State of Haryana, Honorable Supreme Court held 2000 Criminal Law General 1803, Yesu alias Yesu Raja versus State, H. Arun Basha versus State 2018, SEC Online Madras 12845 are the relevant citations in respect of 299 CRPC together with section 33 of Indian Evidence Act. What are the condition precedents in recording evidence in absence of absconding accused? We have already discussed number one, proof that accused has absconded. Number two, there is no immediate prospect of arresting the accused, whether conjunctive or disjunctive. Now we can see proclamation and proclaimed offender. As a matter of fact, the word proclamation and proclaimed offender is not defined anywhere in CRPC. However, the word proclamation is used in section 82, 83, 85, 197, 457 of CRPC. Proclaimed offender appears in section 41B, wherein every officer employed in connection with the affairs of the village, namely maybe a village administrative officer, and every person residing in the village are bound to forthwith communicate the nearest police station about the information he may possess respecting a proclaimed offender. That is the reason why proclamation has been affected. Section 42 sub rule 2 CRPC deals with the expression proclaimed offender, which includes a person proclaimed as an offender by any court in respect of the offense punishable under any of the provisions of IPC, namely 302, 304, 382, 392 to 399, 402, 435, 436, 449, 450 and 457 to 460, both inclusive. Then section 43 of CRPC further provides power to even a private person to arrest a proclaimed offender. Thus, a private person can arrest a proclaimed offender if he has been proclaimed by under section 82. Section 73 says Chief Judicial Magistrate or a magistrate of a first class may direct a warrant to any person with his local jurisdiction for the arrest of any escaped convict, proclaimed offender, or of any person who is accused of a non-bailable offence and is evading arrest, whereas section 82 of CRPC deals with the procedure with regard to proclamation. Now we can understand the difference between proclamation and the proclaimed offender. Nowhere it is stated in section 299 that proclamation shall be issued before recording evidence of witnesses. Thus, the word proclamation is not available in section 299. In Tamil Nadu, Criminal Rules of Practice 2019, Chapter 6, Rule 32 reads, in respect of absconding accused, that the court may proceed under section 82, notwithstanding power of the court to record evidence under section 219 of CRPC. Thus, proclamation is not a condition precedent to examine the witnesses in the absence of the accused under section 299. However, as per section 82.1 of CRPC, before issuing proclamation, the court has to satisfy that the accused has left his permanent residence or he is absconding service or there is no chance of arrest in near future. Thus, to secure the accused and to prove that a proper intimation has been given to appear, the court may publish written proclamation. Put it in other words, if the court satisfy that the accused absconded or NPW cannot be executed, there are three ways. Number one, the court may examine the witnesses under section 299 without going into the provisions of section 82. Number two, issue proclamation under section 82 and then examine the witnesses. Number three, in respect of the offenses mentioned in section 82 sub rule 4 alone, the proclamation and the declaration of proclamation of proclaimed offender is compulsary. Thus, even though section 82 or proclamation is absent in section 299 of CRPC, by way of criminal rules of practice and incorporating some rules, all the honorable high courts are directing the magistrates or the court may initiate proclamation proceedings before recording evidence. It is safe. What are the procedural aspects to issue an order of proclamation? Number one, pending of non-bailable warrant is sine qua non. That without non-bailable warrant is pending, these steps cannot be taken. Thus, pending of non-bailable warrant is sine qua non. Number two, all efforts should have taken to execute the warrant. The unexecuted warrant shall be returned by the police along with a report. Number three. Number four, the court must satisfy itself that accused is concealing and absconding so that warrant cannot be executed before ordering proclamation under section 82. The reasons to be recorded in writing by all the courts that before issuing proclamation notice, the proper reason to be recorded. Then proclamation shall be effected as per section 82 sub rule 2. And a specific date and time shall be stated in the notice, not less than 30 days from the date of publishing such a proclamation. The court shall record the publication was duly complied with. Then even after proclamation, if the accused is not appeared, namely failing appearance of the accused, the court has got four ways. Number one, may proceed to examine the witnesses. May transfer the case to long pending case register. May proceed to attach the property under section 83. May pronounce the accused as proclaimed offender if the offense is very well mentioned in section 82 sub rule 4 of CRPC. Anandan Douglas Devananda versus State by Inspector of Police, is the relevant citation in this in respect of the above procedural aspects. Now, where the court had issued only summons without issuing a warrant of arrest against the accused, that stage has not come. Warrant has not been issued. Only summons has been issued in Neeroji Appala Naidu and others versus Neerojogi Roja, 2006, Criminal Law Journal 3230. The Honorable High Court of Andhra Pradesh held under Section 87 of CRPC, a court may issue warrant instead of or in addition to summon also after recording reason in writing. Thus, after written of summons, a warrant may be issued and then proceed under Section 82. Without issuing warrant by way of written of summons, Section 82 proceedings cannot be initiated, was the verdict held by the Honorable Andhra Pradesh High Court. In Karnataka Rules 125, Chapter 6, Karnataka Criminal Rules of Practice deals with the proclamation proceedings in all warrant cases. In Tamil Nadu, Rule 32 has been framed to proceed under Section 82 in respect of even unserved summon also, Rule 29, Subrule 11, and unexecuted warrant stage also under Rule 37.7. In Andhra Pradesh, Rules 19 to 23. In Kerala, Rule 16 have been framed to that effect, that proclamation shall be issued before recording evidence. How proclamation shall be published by the police is the question now. It shall be publicly read in some notable or easily seen places in which such a person orderly resides. It is better to get certificate from the concerned officer in whose office it was published. It is better to prove that it was duly published. It shall be affixed to some notable, easily seen part of the house or other places in which such accused ordinarily resides. Accused or other person ordinarily resides. It is good to take photograph of the affixed notices to prove that it was duly affixed in the house of the accused. A copy shall be affixed to some other notable or easily seen places and also court, for which photographs can also be taken. The court may also direct a copy of proclamation to be published in a daily newspaper circulating in the place in which such person ordinarily resides. Thus, a copy of newspaper to be obtained to prove that the proclamation has been duly published. Now, how to prove the said publication? Now proclamation has been published by affixing in the few other notable places in the house of the accused, in the workplace of the accused, and also by way of publication, and also in the affixed in the court. Now, how to prove the publication of notice? Direct the police officer or investigating officer to file an affidavit along with the said certificates, photographs, newspaper, etc., stating that he duly published the proclamation or affixed the proclamation notice. On the specific day, direct the office assistant or process server to call the accused thrice in the open court and record his deposition as CW1. Record the deposition of the police officer who published the proclamation notice and who filed affidavit to that effect to be examined as CW2, and mark his report as Exhibit C1. Mark his report means together with photographs, newspaper, certificates, etc. Later, the said deposition and report would prove that proclamation was duly effected under Section 82 of CRPC and it has been duly complied with. Otherwise, the accused may claim that proclamation was not properly effected and he was present in the open court on the said day specified by the court in the proclamation notice, but he was not called. What is the validity or effective period of proclamation? In Jayendra Vishnu Thakur versus State of Maharashtra and another, 2009, 7 SEC 104, the Honorable Supreme Court held that the proclamation continues till the offender is arrested. Once the offender is arrested or appears, the proclamation ceases to operate. He can be punished under Section 174, capital A of IPC. It's not CRPC, it is IPC. What are the punishments for non-appearance in response to a proclamation under Section 82? A plain reading of Section 82 of CRPC and 174, capital A of IPC could clearly point to the situation where the person against whom proclamation is issued under section 82(1) of CRPC would be divided into two categories. The first category would be of the persons who are accused of an offence other than one mentioned in section 82(4) of CRPC. If it is published, may extend to 3 years imprisonment or with a fine or with both. And the second category of the person of the accused of an offence mentioned in section 82(4) of CRPC, if the accused has been proclaimed offender, then the punishment would be 7 years of imprisonment and fine if later he has been produced or surrendered before the court. Thus, there are two provision, 174(A)(1), 174(A)(2), 174(A), 174(A)(1) deals with the accused against whom proclamation has been only published or issued. But in the second category, publication has been effected and he has been declared as proclaimed offender. In such a case, the punishment would be 7 years, otherwise only 3 years. Let me see the differences in detail also in later stage. Whether the court can declare all the accused as proclaimed offender is the question. Whether the court can declare all the accused as proclaimed offender, it is not mandatory in all cases except the offences mentioned in section 82(4) of CRPC. 82(4) of CRPC says that the accused who committed an offence punishable under section 302, 304, 364, 367, 382, 392, 393, 395, 396, 397, 398, 399, 400, 402, 436, 449, 459 and 460 of IPC alone can be declared as proclaimed offender. Thus, as per section 82 sub-rule 4 of CRPC, the other offenders cannot be declared as proclaimed offender is the rule. Section 82(4) and 82(5) sub-rules are included by way of amendment on 23-6-2006. Similarly, section 174(A) also introduced by way of amendment on the same day, 23-6-2006. However, there is no bar in initiating proclamation proceedings under section 82(1) of CRPC in all cases, but the accused cannot be declared as proclaimed offender except under section 82(4) of CRPC. I have also mentioned a few relevant citations, Geetha Ramachandran versus S. Ravichandran, in which under section 150, the proclamation notice was issued in the case under section 138 of Negotiable Instrument Act also. An application was filed before the magistrate to issue proclamation, but it was dismissed by the magistrate. The accused approached the Honorable High Court. The Honorable High Court held that and directed the magistrate to proceed under section 82(1) of CRPC and proclaim the notice. But proclaimed offender is not necessary. Then one more case also, yes, Raja Purna Chandran versus Inspector of Police, 28th September 2017. Also, the Honorable High Court directed the magistrate to issue proclamation notice under section 82 and desire the application under section 451 of CRPC in respect of return of the cash which was seized from the three accused who were subsequently absconded. The court directed that to issue proclamation under section 82, record the depositions and thereafter decide the application under section 451. Then another case also, Arun Kumar Parihar versus State NCTD, and the Honorable High Court of Delhi held that unless the offences are mentioned under section 82(4), the other offenders cannot be proclaimed as proclaimed offender, was the judgment of the Honorable High Court of Delhi. Now the question is whether the accused committed an offence not falling under section 82(4) of CRPC can be declared as proclaimed offender. The offence which is not mentioned in section 82(4), which I have already read. A person committing an offence not falling under section 82(4) of CRPC can also be declared as proclaimed offender, which was held in Srimati Deeksha Puri versus State of Haryana, 2008 2013 1 RCR criminal 159, the Honorable Punjab and Haryana High Court held that a person committing an offence not falling under section 82(4) can be declared proclaimed offender and will be subject to penalties and liabilities enshrined under law. The provisions of section 82(4) do not lay down that the persons accused of having committed offences mentioned in section 82(4) of CRPC can only be declared a proclaimed offender. The Honorable High Court held that it is not specifically mentioned in section 82(4) that the offences which are not mentioned in section 82(4) cannot be declared as proclaimed offender. Thus, it was held like that. Further, it is held that any person who has been declared a proclaimed person under section 82(1) or under section 82(4), there are two ways. One, under section 82(1), a proclamation can be issued. 82(4), he can be declared as proclaimed offender. Both will be at par for the purpose of all liabilities and the consequences attached to a person declared proclaimed offender. The absconder not falling under section 82 subrule 4 of CRPC are liable under section 144 capital A part 1 of IPC, and absconders under section 82(4) subrule 4 of CRPC are liable under section 174 capital A part 2 of IPC. That was the differentiation given by the Honorable Punjab and Haryana High Court. You may declare both under both as a proclaimed offender, but you cannot punish the proclaimed offender who are not mentioned in section 82 subrule 4, and they can be punished only under part 1 of 174 capital A. But the absconders under section 82(4) of CRPC are liable under section 174 capital A part 2 of IPC after publishing of proclamation. Thus the proclamation of publishing proclamation, declaration of proclamation is must to punish the accused under section 174 capital A part 2. Then it is also held that order of declaring a person of proclaimed offender cannot be challenged solely on the ground that the offence alleged to have been committed by him is not included in the section mentioned in section 82(4) of CRPC. It is excellent sentence given by the Honorable High Court. Order of declaring a person of a proclaimed offender, even though under section 82(1) or 82(4), cannot be challenged solely on the ground that the offence alleged to have been committed by him is not included in the sections mentioned in section 82 subrule 4 of CRPC. Now we can see the differences between the proclaimed person and the proclaimed offender. The Honorable Haryana High Court classified these two definitions: proclaimed person, proclaimed offender. Proclaimed person is not defined under CRPC also. All the persons who are absconding or are concealing themselves to avoid execution of warrant of arrest could be proclaimed persons, but they could be declared a proclaimed offender only under the provisions of IPC, which are mentioned in section 82(4) of CRPC. There is stark distinction between a proclaimed person and a proclaimed offender. And for that reason, there is a difference of punishment provided under section 174 capital A of IPC, as it provides imprisonment which may extend up to 3 years, or with a fine, or with both, regarding a person who has been proclaimed in the terms of section 82(1) of CRPC. And the imprisonment which may extend to 7 years, and also with a fine, in respect of a person who is declared a proclaimed offender under section 82(4) of CRPC. A person who is avoiding the execution of warrants of arrest issued under a particular section of IPC, which are mentioned in section 82(4) of CRPC, can only be declared to be a proclaimed offender. And other persons under the other provisions of IPC and the laws can be declared to be proclaimed person in terms of section 82(1) of CRPC. Thus, even the persons under the other provisions of IPC or any other law can be declared to be a proclaimed person, not proclaimed offender, in terms of section 82(1) of CRP. Thus we can differentiate the two provisions under section 82(1) proclaimed person, under section 82(4) proclaimed offender. It is held in Rahul Datta versus State of Haryana 2012 2 RCR criminal 585, followed by Sanjay Sharin versus State Union Territory Chandigarh Chandigarh 2013 criminal law journal 408 Punjab and Haryana High Court. It's not Haryana High Court, Punjab and Haryana High Court. Thus now we could understand the differentiation between proclaimed person and proclaimed offender, section 82(1) and section 82(4) and 174 capital A part 1 of IPC and section 174 capital A part 2 of IPC. And the next is heading is anticipatory bail. When a person against whom a warrant had been issued and is absconding or concealing himself in order to avoid execution of warrant and declared as a proclaimed offender in terms of section 82 of CRPC is not entitled to relief of anticipatory bail. Thus, a person declared as proclaimed offender is not entitled to anticipatory benefits under anticipatory bail provision. Lavesh versus State of NCT of Delhi 2012 8 ACC 730, it is held that anticipatory bail application is not patentable. The Honorable Supreme Court went one step further in State of Madhya Pradesh versus Pradeep Sharma AR 2014 Supreme Court 626. The Honorable Appellate Court did not grant anticipatory bail to the applicant therein, despite the fact that the applicant was not declared to be a proclaimed offender. He was not declared as a proclaimed offender, even though the Honorable High Court held that since the proclamation under section 82 proceedings has been initiated against him, he is not entitled to anticipatory bail. However, Honorable Madhya Pradesh High Court Gwalior bench observed on 12th May 2020 that if an accused is declared as absconder under section 82 of CRPC, he is not entitled to the relief of anticipatory bail, but it does not preclude him from filing an application for seeking of anticipatory bail. Thus, he can file an application even though it is stated in the Honorable Supreme Court judgments that he is not entitled to. Similar view was taken by the Honorable Himachal Pradesh High Court on 30th October 2020 that the anticipatory bail application is maintainable. In Suresh Chandra Khandelwal versus State of Chhattisgarh, dated 20th August 2020, the Honorable High Court took a view that if procedure prescribed under section 82 of CRPC is not followed before declaring an accused absconder, such accused is not disentitled for availing the benefit of anticipatory bail under section 438 of CRPC. Though his application was considered under section 482 of CRPC and not under section 438 of CRPC. Interestingly, in Aravind Sen versus State of Uttar Pradesh, the Honorable Allahabad High Court recently on 25th January 2021 held that following the Honorable Supreme Court judgments I have earlier mentioned, Lavesh versus State and State of Madhya Pradesh versus Pradeep Sharma, that it is clear from the above decisions that if anyone is declared as an absconder or proclaimed offender in terms of section 82 of CRPC, he is not entitled to the relief of anticipatory bail. Therefore, whenever it is brought before the court that the applicant seeking anticipatory bail is deliberately not cooperating with the investigation or is absconding and has been declared to be proclaimed offender, then the court would be slow in granting anticipatory bail to such person, was the words used by the Honorable High Court of Allahabad. Thus, whether anticipatory bail application is maintainable or not, the Honorable Supreme Court said it is not maintainable. Few Honorable High Courts said it is maintainable under section 482 and even under section 439 if the procedure under section 82 is not properly complied with. That thus I am again emphasizing that the compliance of section 82 and section 299 CRPC is very, very important. Section 219 of CRPC being an exception, it is necessary that all the conditions prescribed must be strictly complied with. Let me conclude, Mr. Vikas ji, and sum up the procedure in simple way. What we have discussed for the last 45 minutes, I am going to sum up now. Number one, issue warrant. Number two, get back the unexecuted warrant with a report. Number three, may initiate proceedings against the sureties. Number four, record the reasons in writing after get back the unexecuted warrant. Number five, issue proclamation under section 82 by giving minimum 30 days time, though not mandatory under section 219 of CRPC, since the Honorable High Courts are insisting to comply with section 82 before recording section 299. Even some Honorable High Courts rules are framed to the effect that permission has to be obtained from the Honorable Session Judge. Then number six, may attach the movable or immovable properties of the accused simultaneously while proceeding under section 82. Convert, as soon as proceedings has been initiated under section 82, convert the regular calendar case or preliminary register case or sessions case into a long pending case. Number eight, make necessary entries in LPC register. Number nine, wait for minimum 30 days statutory period as prescribed under section 82.1 of CRPC. There must be a clear gap of 30 days. Number 10, receive the affidavit with records in proof of proclamation. Number 11, on the specific day, if accused absent, record the same in the notes paper. Examine the office assistant and the police officer as CW1 and CW2 and exhibit the report and the proof of proclamation as CW1, as exhibit C1, not CW1, as exhibit C1. Since we have to record depositions of two persons, namely office assistant and police officer, and we have to mark the report and the proof produced by the police officer. Number 12, start recording the evidence of witnesses in the absence of accused. Now, section 299 CRPC comes into play. Start recording evidence of witnesses in the absence of the accused. 13, if the offences committed are available in section 82.4, declare him as a proclaimed offender and receive the affidavit with records in proof of declaration. Again, we have to collect the proof in respect of proclamation or declaration of proclaimed offender also to be proclaimed. Collect that report and then start recording. This is the difference between section 82.1 and 82.4. Under section 82.1, we need not declare him as the proclaimed offender. We can proceed to record evidence, but under section 82.4, we have to declare him as a proclaimed offender and receive proof for that, and subsequently we have to start recording evidence under section 299. Number 14, keep the long pending case without giving any date of hearing. The said long pending case, which was converted from a regular case, has to be kept pending without giving any date of hearing. The earlier regular case has to be closed. Then number 15, issue fresh NBW warrant mentioning long pending case number, LPC number 1, LPC number 2 of 2021, like that. Number 16, wait for its execution or surrender of the accused or his death. Number 17, if the witness is dead, incapable of giving evidence, or his attendance would cause unreasonable delay, expense or inconvenience, then use the deposition which was recorded under section 299 CRPC against the accused, who is produced by the police or voluntarily appears. Number 18, if the case is split up against the absconded accused, initiate the proceedings under section 82, but need not wait for completion of that proceedings. Convert as LPC and start recording evidence along with the parent case. There is a specific rule in Tamil Nadu rules of criminal rules of practice, Tamil Nadu. If unknown offender, do the same exercise or procedure on the directions of the Honorable High Court or Session Judge. Without the direction, if the offense is punishable for death or imprisonment for life. Without direction, we cannot record evidence. A direction must be obtained from the Honorable High Court or Session Judge. Both the said courts have to give direction to record evidence in respect of unknown offender. Now I am concluding. When the warrant is pending, if the aforesaid procedures are strictly followed by all courts, then the accused would have no guts to abscond or leave the country. Thank you.
They say that good things come with delay, and when we started off, there were certain aberrations, but eventually it turned out to be very well. This is, can a person who has been arrested declared as proclaimed offender if he has escaped custody?
Little louder.
Can a person who has been arrested be declared as a proclaimed offender if he has escaped custody?
No, your voice is not clear. Please put it in the chat box, ji. Chat box, I'll answer. Please. Judge, my voice are clear? Good, thank you. Judge, now you can put your question, even in the audio format.
Posted the question.
Yes, posted, ji. Have you posted?
Yeah, you can post it another question.
Can the de facto complainant move a petition before the trial court to issue proclamation notice and to declare the accused as proclaimed offender under such circumstances when the prosecution is not taking steps for that? Shwarji, there are applications are being filed. It is maintainable. One more question also I have seen in the chat box. Even under section 138 proceedings also, such application can be filed under section 82. To take initiate action under section 82. It can be filed.
One question by Umesh Gandhi.
Yes.
But this is not with the present session. We will take only.
Sure. I'll take one by one. Yes, one Mr. Pragadish Iyer stated that, sir, if witnesses are examined in absence of accused and he is convicted, and under what circumstances can such conviction be overturned if convict remained unavailable? Question is not correct. If witnesses are examined in the absence of accused, he cannot be convicted. The records to be kept pending until his arrival, until he is produced, and or until he is dead. The court cannot convict or acquit or discharge him based on the evidence recorded under section 270-299. I have also mentioned, Jay, with section also it cannot be. Then the next question is, in the malicious prosecution of atrocity case, accused is very much regular to the proceedings. One fateful day, accused got up. On the day, IO deposition occurred. In any way, the case got acquitted, but the accused had requested for proper cross of investigation officer. That did not occur, and remedy to the accused is gained. He has to prefer only appeal. Once case is not pending before that court, he cannot file an application before the same trial court. He has to file an appeal before the proper forum. If warrant is pending and any other stage, then he can he has to file application under section 311 of CRPC for cross examination if judgment is not pronounced. Even before judgment is pronounced, an application is maintainable under section 311. What is the relevance of section 299 in proceedings under unlawful activities prevention act? Same procedure to be followed. Initiate 82 proceedings and then go for 299. Thus, 82(4) is not applicable to other laws. Only in respect of IPC, section 82 subrule 4 is applicable.
Last question we have posted. Can a juvenile be declared a proclaimed offender?
Juvenile can be declared as proclaimed offender. Juvenile can be declared as a proclaimed offender. I have not come across any such answer. I'll post it. I'll post it in letter in the group.
And kindly share the judgment. We can share it in the group itself later on.
Sure. I'll also circulate my notes to you.
Yeah, thank you.
I have prepared the notes with citations also.
Yeah, that would be
fantastic. It will be useful to the juniors.
Yes. So, friends, like we had previously been connected with Mr. A.S. Ravi, his sessions are quite insightful and they are quite engaging. And we are happy that he has shared his knowledge, though after quite a lot of time. And tomorrow, friends, we will be having a session on interpretation of statutes, a mischief rule by Mr. E. Om Prakash, a senior advocate from Madras High Court. Do stay connected with us tomorrow at 6 p.m. Thank you, everyone. Stay safe, stay blessed. And keep on wearing your mask and maintain social distancing as well as get your vaccination done. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Ravi. Thank you.